Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, here to talk a little bit more in depth about how exactly SpaceX lands rockets and what that even means. We're going to answer some of those important questions like, why don't they just use parachutes? And why is this so hard exactly? To answer that, we're going to be doing some fun experiments in using a few examples in Kerbal Space Program. Let's get started.
1-0 for liftoff. 1-4
First things first, what's so special about landing a rocket? Well, if you haven't seen my video titled, Why Throw Rockets Away When We Can Reuse Them, I suggest you start there. The idea of reusing a rocket isn't some groundbreaking idea SpaceX had. People have been wanting to do it since the beginning of launching rockets. Heck, I'm sure the first people that were building a rocket were sitting there going, dang it, I really wish we could just reuse this instead of letting it crash into the ocean when it's done. That's one thing the space shuttle system tried to accomplish. One of the main goals of the space shuttle was to recover and reuse those expensive engines on the back of the orbiter, which in theory would bring down the cost. Now, we're not going to get into exactly why that didn't quite pan out in today's video, but do know we've been thinking about reusing rockets since rockets have existed, and we even had some really cool plans to reuse the first stage of a Saturn V way back in the 1960s. What SpaceX decided to do was to use the main engines of their rocket to slow themselves down and make a soft landing. So the first question comes up, why did they use engines instead of parachutes? Well, check this out.
I'm up here on the second story of a building, and it's actually really windy out, which is perfect to test which is more accurate, a rocket with a parachute or a rocket without a parachute. Now, if only I carried a rocket around with me at all times, which of course I do. 3, 2, 1,
hip it.
There we go, we nailed it. Here it is with a parachute now. Let's see how accurate this thing is. 3, 2, 1,
hip hip.
Oh yeah, way off.
A parachute landing is not what we'd call precise. Depending on the wind, the landing area could cover several miles of land, and that may lead to a 156-foot tall, 18-ton rocket landing in the middle of some crowded parking lot somewhere, or perhaps into a giant pit of angry alligators down at Kennedy Space Center. That same wind might end up making the rocket travel sideways across the ground, which means when it hits the ground, it would likely tip over due to going too quickly horizontally. But believe it or not, a parachute and supporting structure that would allow an 18-ton rocket to hang from said parachute would actually be a lot heavier than just having a little more fuel on board to fire up the engines again to land with. So why exactly is landing a rocket booster so challenging? Why did it take until 2015 to land an orbital class booster in the first place? One of the biggest challenges is the sheer size of everything and all the forces involved. Here's a few really crazy examples. When the first stage lets go of the second stage, it's going over 4,000 miles an hour and over 70 miles above the surface of the Earth. Now don't forget, this is a 15-story tall building, and this either needs to turn around and come back and land back near the launch pad. Well, it can't always do that. It depends on how big the payload is. Or it follows its ballistic trajectory and ends up landing on a football field-sized boat some 200 plus miles away from the launch pad. This stuff is crazy. The rocket makes a series of burns to perfectly aim itself at its target either back on land near the launch pad or out at sea on the drone ship. When the rocket's above the atmosphere, it doesn't have any air to push against, so it uses these little nitrogen thrusters to help maneuver itself. But once the rocket is back into the atmosphere, it has what are called grid fins, and these will actually help steer itself through the air. These full-time grid fins and part-time world's largest waffle makers act a lot like the fins of a dart. Imagine your hand out the window of a car going 60 miles per hour. That force is pretty strong, even at 60 miles per hour. Now imagine you're traveling at over 1,000 miles an hour. Yeah, those little things have an awful lot of force. Another technical achievement SpaceX made in order to land its rockets is perfecting this maneuver known as a hover slam. This is where they come to zero velocity at the exact same time they come to zero altitude. What the heck does this mean? Well, here's an example. Imagine you're in a car and the brakes can only be completely on or completely off. There's no in between. Now pretend you're going down a street and you're trying to stop exactly at a crosswalk. Start braking too early and you'll end up, say, 20 feet short of the crosswalk. Start braking too late and you'll end up somewhere beyond the crosswalk. Well, this is exactly what the Falcon 9 is calculating while it's trying to land. is trying to find out that precise moment when it basically slams on its engine in order to make a soft and precise touchdown. Okay, so this example might be a little extreme, because rocket engines can actually be throttled, which means the thrust can either increase or decrease, leaving a little margin of error. But at this point, the rocket is basically running on fumes, so this maneuver needs to be really precise and has been really tricky to perfect. One quick note is that we have been specifically talking about SpaceX this whole time, although there's another rocket company out there known as Blue Origin, who's also perfected the hover slam maneuver. But they've been doing this with their much smaller suborbital rocket known as the New Shepard. But within a few years, we hope to see their orbital class big brother known as New Glenn, which will use similar methods to reuse their rockets. Reusability may be the holy grail that makes space more accessible, cheaper, and much, much cooler. I, for one, can't wait to see a first stage rocket falling out of the sky and landing in person. So far, I've missed all the rockets that have landed back on land, but I really hope to catch one soon. And I will bring it to you guys, so stay tuned. Make sure and hit subscribe for more fun, funny, and factual content. Thank you so much to my Patreon supporters for helping make this video possible. If you want to help crowdfund this and other Everyday Astronaut content, please visit patreon.com/everydayastronaut. Let me know what questions or comments you have about rockets or space in the comments below. Or just make fun of that really ugly car I made in Kerbal Space Program. Sorry about that. Well, that does it for me. I'm Tim Dodd, the Everyday Astronaut, bringing space down to Earth for everyday people.